Our text this morning is John chapter 12, verses 1 through 19. Then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany where Lazarus was, who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead. There they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with him. Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, "Why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box, and he used to take what was put in it. But Jesus said, "Let her alone. She has kept this for the day of my burial. For the poor you have with you always, but me you do not have always." Now a great many of the Jews knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might also see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests plotted to put Lazarus to death also, because on account of him many of the Jews went away and believed in Jesus. The next day a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it, as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him. Therefore, the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of his tomb and raised him from the dead bore witness. For this reason, the people also met him, because they heard that he had done this sign. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, "You see that you are accomplishing nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that we have the privilege of assembling before you now. We know that we approach only in the blood of your Son, our Savior. We thank you for his sacrifice, for his obedience on our behalf, for his faithfulness where we were faithless. Father, would you direct our eyes to your Son as we come to this text? May we understand his perfect work. May we see it with the eyes of faith, and by that faith, may that perfect work become ours. We pray these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, and amen. So now we move on from the book of signs, the first 11 chapters of John, to the second half of John, which is really just the final week of the life of Jesus. And in this little section here that I've just read, the first half of chapter 12, we see two responses to Jesus' final sign, the raising of Lazarus from the dead. So the culmination of all of Jesus' miracle working and the proclamation of who he was. And you get this really, I think, sort of stark contrast of two different ways of responding to what Jesus has done. We get Mary, who gave her testimony in chapter 11, verse 27. She said to him, "Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." Mary has given this testimony of faith, and now in this moment, the anointing at Bethany, she demonstrates her faith by showing her complete and total devotion to Jesus in the anointing. So you get Mary's response to what Jesus has done for Lazarus in the anointing at Bethany. And then in stark contrast to that, you get the chief priests, the Pharisees, and Judas the betrayer all responding to the raising of Lazarus by planning the murder of both Jesus and Lazarus. And it's interesting, I'll point this out a few times, but that these two people, it's not like Mary saw one thing and the chief priests or Judas didn't get to see those things, and so he wasn't able to be convinced. They're all witnesses to the same events, but those same events produce two very different responses. Let's start this first bit with the anointing at Bethany. He tells us here that we're 6 days before the Passover. So you have everybody returning to Jerusalem once more for another one of the pilgrim feasts. It's 6 days before, which is, we're a week ahead of time. But if you can think about it for a moment, you have a lot of people who are traveling from a great distance. So they tend to show up early because they have to give themselves a little bit of room for travel on the road for possible delays. And then you also have the fact that when you get there to celebrate the Passover, if you have any ritual impurity, you have to go through a series of ceremonies to be ritually pure in order to celebrate Passover. So it's common for people to be showing up to Jerusalem a bit early to prepare for the Passover. And so at this moment, you've got Jews from all over Israel and really from all over the known world at that time descending on Jerusalem. And so basically all the hotels in Jerusalem have filled up, and then the surrounding villages all start to fill up as well. We're told earlier that Bethany is about 2 miles from Jerusalem, so it's kind of a spillover village for people that are traveling to Jerusalem. So the crowds are gathering to Jerusalem in the run-up to Passover, and everything is starting to fill up. Now, the other Gospels tell us that when this anointing happens, they're in the house of Simon the leper, who we assume must have been the father of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, but we don't see him appear now. So maybe he's passed on, and it's just the three kids that are living in the house. And in this scene, Martha, typical Martha, what we know of her, she's serving. She's taking care of the kitchen and running the food. She's serving. Mary, however, comes out with 1 pound of spikenard to anoint Jesus with. The spikenard is apparently an extremely expensive spice that you had to source from northern India in order to get it. So it was this extremely expensive spice that she has an entire pound that she is going to lavishly sort of pour out on Jesus. It's something that only the wealthy would have owned. And the amount that she has here, we're told that it's or 300 denarii, this means it's basically the equivalent of up to maybe one whole year of someone's salary. So it's one whole year of a salary that she has taken and she is pouring out on Jesus at this moment. Jesus says in verse 7, when Judas complains about it, he says, "Let her alone. She has kept this for the day of my burial." That phrase that she has kept this means that she's been storing it up. So a lot of people conclude that this was perhaps her entire inheritance that had been passed on to her. So this is her whole inheritance. And she sees this moment and she goes and she pours it out all out on Jesus. Now, the question is, what does the anointing here mean? All right, she takes this oil and she pours that on his feet and she wipes his feet with her hair. So first of all, it's clearly a sign of devotion. You see that Mary is demonstrating her complete devotion to Christ. She's taking that statement of faith that was in the previous chapter, and she's demonstrating how much she believes it and how much she is pouring herself out for Christ. Everything here, I think, indicates that she intended by this to communicate her complete and utter devotion to Jesus. So for instance, first of all, to anoint his feet rather than his head. Right, you normally, when you would anoint someone's head, but she chooses instead to anoint his feet. She may have anointed his head also, but she, the text focuses on the fact that she anoints his feet. That in and of itself is to show this deep humility. If you think about, remember John the Baptist in chapter 1, verse 27, he says that he's not worthy to even remove the sandal straps of Jesus. So it's like if you take the man and there's the man and you're going over the body, the feet are the lowest piece. They're the most humble of his body. And John says, I'm not worth even going to his feet. So the fact that when Mary goes to his feet to pour out her entire wealth, she's picking the lowest part of Christ and saying, I'm down here and I will pour this out just on the very on your feet. Your feet are worth my entire inheritance. And then so she's saying that he is far, far above her. But then on top of that, then to wipe his feet with her hair. Remember, the woman's hair at this time has like real significant symbolic importance. How a woman wore her hair said what kind of woman she was. And Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11 that her hair is considered her glory, right? It's her glory. This is the glory of the woman. So we have Jesus' feet, the lowest part, and we have the woman's hair, her glory, her highest part, as she takes her hair and uses it to wipe his feet. It's clearly an action that is chosen to indicate how much devotion and how much love she has for him, how she understands who he is and her whole life is his. So in that moment, I think Mary is showing us what evangelical faith looks like, that she is utterly devoted. But there's more than just that, okay? There's more than just she's showing how much she really, really loves Jesus. Anointing is also how you declare that someone is a king. The word we call Jesus Christ. The word Christ is the Greek word that corresponds to the Hebrew word Mashiach, or Mashiach, which would be Messiah. But Mashiach just means anointed. It means someone who has had the oil poured out on them. Christ just means someone who is anointed. A king is a Christ. A king is a Messiah, because the way you make someone a king is you pour oil on them. In America, we make a president a president by having them, you know, put their hand on the Bible and swear them in. In the Old Testament, the way you make someone a king is you pour oil on them. Remember, Samuel makes Saul a king by anointing him with oil. He declares David. Remember when he lines up all of Jesse's sons and he says, which one is going to be king? And David is the one that's selected. How does he indicate that David is the one that's selected? He pours oil on his head. He anoints him. He mashocks him, or he Christs him. Okay. So a king is someone who has had the oil poured out on their head. Jesus Christ is Jesus King because he is Jesus anointed. You declare someone to be king by anointing them with oil. So it's interesting then, if you go back to chapter 12 for a moment, all right, we're looking at the first 11 verses, but just go on a little bit, because on the next morning, we're going to have the triumphal entry. And what do they say when Jesus walks into Jerusalem the next day? Look at verse 13. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Or drop down to verse 15. Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. Jesus is about to be declared king, and Mary is anointing him as king. She's pouring oil on him. She is anointing him. There's a great line in the Song of Solomon where the young woman, she says, this is Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 12. While the king is at his table, my spikenard sends forth its fragrance. Okay, the king is at his table, and the woman who is in love with the king, all right, her spikenard fills the room. The smell of it fills the room. I have to think that there's some reference to that verse in John's mind when he described the room in verse 3. Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil. That smell of the spikenard filling the room means the king is at the table and he has been anointed with the oil. So the king is at the table. The devoted woman is at his feet with perfume filling the room. Now remember that Luke, when he tells this story, he says that that Jesus promised that wherever the gospel was preached, that this picture, this story of Mary and her devotion would go with it. And I think it's a great and fitting picture of what it looks like to receive the Messiah, the one who is anointed. But the funny thing is that this is not how Jesus explains it. He doesn't say, she's anointing me as king. Look at verse 7. Jesus said, let her alone. She has kept this for the day of my burial. Right? Jesus says, it's not for me being king. This is for me to be buried. This is for my coming and impending death. He says it's for his funeral. It's customary to put spices on the bodies. Remember that Joseph of Arimathea takes Jesus' body off the cross and wraps him in spices and puts him in the tomb. So it was common to do that. So Jesus says that the anointing he is receiving is actually for his funeral. And the thing is that I would say these look like two very different moments to us, you know, anointing a king versus you've got the inauguration of a king versus preparing the funeral of a man who's been executed for a crime. Okay, those look like two very different kinds of moments. But I think that Jesus sees that these are the same thing, right? Jesus sees that these are the same thing. His throne that he's being anointed to was a cross, right? His throne is a cross. He ascends to rule by going through a terrible death. So as I said, to be anointed is to be the Christ, is to be made king. To be anointed with oil is to be the Christ, to be made king. But to be the Christ of the Bible, is to be on the cross, okay? To be anointed is to be Christ, but to be Christ is to be on the cross. And so I think these two moments come together and come together in this really sort of powerful kind of way. It's a really beautiful scene, but what's interesting is at that moment, now all this is playing out, and it is crazy how, you know, he says a little bit later that the people, like, they didn't understand what they were doing. Like, there's so much coming true at this moment. And the people, they don't understand what they're doing because God is moving too fast for them to keep up in the way he's telling this story. It's sort of like when Jesus is on the cross and he says, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." And he's speaking about the people who are executing him. The people, none of the people knew what they did, right? Not the people who are praising him and laying down palm branches, not the people who are executing, because God is moving too fast for him. And it makes it kind of fun to go back over the text and you start to slowly unpack all that is going on at this moment. And it's a beautiful scene with Mary here, but at the very same moment that you have Mary doing this, you have Judas sitting at the same table. He's at the exact same time that you have Mary, you have Judas. And we're told in verse 6 that, you know, he's upset about the fact that there is this extravagant waste on Jesus' feet. And he says that we should have saved this and sold it for the 300 denarii and given it to the poor. But then if we find out in verse 6, this he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box and he used to take what was put in it. He had the money box, which was, I think it was customary when you had like a rabbi that had a number of disciples. One of the disciples had all of the money. So when Jesus is going some places, you've got basically the treasurer who is paying for all of their needs, their food, their lodging, whatever, out of this money box. And apparently that was Judas's job. But we find out the reason he liked having this job was because he kind of had sticky fingers. He liked to help himself to the money that was in the box. And so his supposedly pious concern was actually just a front for his greed. Right? He has this pious front, but it was actually to cover up this greed. Just a quick aside, we should learn a couple of quick things about helping the poor from this. First, Jesus says that the poor will always exist. Okay, and he's probably quoting here Deuteronomy 15:11. The poor you will have with you always. That means then that the existence of some form of relative poverty is not a sign that a culture has done something wrong. Okay, the existence of some sort of relative poverty is not a sign that the culture has done something wrong. There will always be unequal material wealth that we live in. And that does not, the fact that somebody does not have as much as somebody else is not a sign that culture has done something wrong. The poor, he says, they will be with you always. Now, that's not an excuse to not help the poor. In fact, I think Jesus' argument here is that means that you have a life of taking care of the poor in front of you. So it's the fact that the poor will be with you always does not mean, therefore, ignore them. It means you have a life of taking care of the poor, but in this one moment, there's good reason for pouring out this extravagance on Jesus. But the existence of poverty is not a sign that a culture has done something wrong. That's not an excuse to do nothing to help the poor. We will be doing that always. But the mere existence of poverty does not mean that society has failed. Second, the other thing to note here is that trying to make people feel guilty about the existence of poverty, just the mere existence of poverty, the unequal distribution of wealth, and then leveraging that guilt. So make people feel guilty for it, and then leveraging that guilt for donations, all right? That is the thief's tactic, okay? That is a liar's tactic and one that we ought not to fall for. There are plenty of reasons to give to the poor, but Christians give out of gratitude, not guilt. We give out of gratitude about how much God has given us, and so we want to share and give to others, not because our arm has been twisted to feel guilty for something that actually is a design feature in creation. Now, back to Judas. Remember in the very last verse of chapter 11, now both the chief priests and the Pharisees had given a command that if anyone knew where he was, Jesus, he should report it that they might seize him. Okay, the command has gone out from the chief priests and the Pharisees that, look, we need you all to be on the lookout for Jesus, and we need somebody to be the person who comes to us and tells us when and where he is so that we can arrest him. Okay, the Pharisees and the chief priests are looking for a traitor to hand Jesus over. If you think about it for a moment at this time, it's not like they couldn't put up wanted posters for Jesus, right? They can't put up wanted posters. They can't call each other on the cell phone to coordinate an arrest. They know of the existence of Jesus, but many of them may not have ever even seen him and know what he looks like. They just know that someone is causing this great trouble and everybody in Israel is going after him. And they need to find a moment where they can identify this person, but identify him privately and quietly so that they can arrest him, not when he's teaching in the middle of the temple and their arrest would likely cause some sort of open revolution. They need to do it privately and quietly and in secret. And in order to do that, they have to have somebody on the inside, one of his disciples, somebody that's on the inside, help them to coordinate that moment. And so that's where they've sent out this word. We need somebody to come and tell us when and where he'll be somewhere where we can capture him, okay? They needed a Judas. And in this scene, we see Judas getting ready to become that inside man. We see the true colors of Judas's heart, and we see that he's willing to be that inside man. And so it's interesting then to put those two things alongside each other. You've got Mary's devotion, and then you've got Judas's duplicity and his intent to betray the Messiah. So then, the next day, when Jesus enters Jerusalem, and he's riding on a donkey, as was prophesied by Zechariah, the crowds come and they meet him with palm branches, and they're crying out, Hosanna, as they're laying the palm branches down before him. And as I said before, at this moment, there's so much going on in the symbolism that it's impossible to keep up, because all sorts of different things are happening at this moment. The people themselves did not understand what it was they were doing. First, as I've already argued, he's entering Jerusalem as a king. He is the king who has finally come to Jerusalem. If you remember in chapter 1, when Nathanael first meets Jesus, he says, Rabbi, you are the Son of God, you are the King of Israel. He was the first one to declare Jesus to be king. And then that realization is slowly working its way throughout the whole Gospel of John until this moment where all the crowds recognize that he is the king. Zechariah had prophesied the king, when he comes in, he's going to come in on a donkey. And what's interesting also is you have in like the two centuries just leading up to this moment, you have a couple centuries prior to this, you have the Maccabean Revolt, where you have a Jewish group of faithful men, where you had the Greeks take over Israel and take over Jerusalem, and then you had the Jews retake Jerusalem. And they have to do it a couple of different times, where Jerusalem is captured by the Greeks, and then the Maccabees recapture Jerusalem. And each time when they recapture Jerusalem and the new king comes in, what you find, you see this in the book of Maccabees, in 1st and 2nd Maccabees, when the new king comes in, they've just conquered Jerusalem and the king is coming in to take over Jerusalem, you'll find that each time the people line the street with palm branches and they're waving palm branches and throwing palm branches before the king as he comes in. So this is like a moment that for them, this is really symbolic. Like they know we're welcoming the king with the palm branches. And you had to work to do this, because I think palm branches didn't actually grow in Jerusalem. You had to go down to Jericho to get palm branches to have the right symbol for the moment. So you had to really mean it to be waiting there for the king when he walked in with the palm branches to greet him. So So he is the king. He was just anointed by Mary, and he is the king riding in on the donkey, greeted by palm branches coming into Jerusalem with everybody saying, "This is the king." But remember, here's the other thing. Remember that everyone is here in Jerusalem. Why are they here? They're all here getting ready for Passover. John told us that the anointing at Bethany happened 6 days before the Passover, probably on Saturday night, the evening of the Sabbath, after the Sabbath was over. That would mean that the next day, which is when Jesus is having his triumphal entry, would actually be the Sunday before the Passover. And according to Exodus 12:3, this would be the day that the Jews were to select and set aside their lamb for celebrating Passover. So this is the day where you're supposed to pick your lamb to celebrate Passover, and all the people gather and they're welcoming Jesus into the town. They're picking their lamb, all right? He is the Passover lamb. We know that as well. So he's the king, but he's the Passover lamb. He's the anointed one, but he's also the one who's going to be the one on the cross. But there's more. The people are crying out, "Hosanna," and they're singing from Psalm 118. What's interesting is, if we go back to one of the other pilgrim feasts, remember Feast of Booths, which has been really large throughout the Gospel of John up till now. In the Feast of Booths, the culmination of the Feast of Booths is the people coming to the altar and with palm branches along with other branches and crying out, "Hosanna," and quoting this verse from Psalm 118 and throwing the palm branches on to the altar. There's this Feast of Booths that is all coming in here as well. It's like every story in the history of Israel is all coming together and intersecting at this one moment, and it's hard to kind of keep up. We could go on for some time showing how many different prophecies are being fulfilled at this moment as Jesus walks into Jerusalem. Basically, as Jesus enters the city, you have all of the Bible coming true at one moment. And it's too much for the believers, for those who believe, to drink it all in. And it's too much for those that reject Jesus to be able to stand it. So think for a moment about the contrast that John has given us. You've got Mary, and then you've got Judas. You've got the crowds who saw Lazarus and who believed. And then you've got the chief priests and the Pharisees who saw Lazarus and want to kill him, right? You've got this strange kind of contrast of people here. And the difference between the two people, as I said before, or the two crowds or two categories, is not what they know or what they have seen or what they have experienced, because they've all seen, they've all experienced, they all know the same things. They both saw Lazarus. For some, he's the seventh sign. For some, he's the one that needs to die. He's the proof that needs to be buried and gotten rid of somehow. The difference is that one group has a soft heart and the other a hard heart, okay? You've got a soft heart ready to receive it and ready to be a Mary, to give all her inheritance, to humble herself before Christ, or you've got the hard heart, the one who's incensed at the fact that this is the Messiah. So what's the difference between those two? How do you get to that kind of hard heart? Like, how do you become the kind of person who can have Lazarus raised from the dead in front of you and all you can think is, "I want to kill him," right? How do you get to that kind of hard heart? Or maybe a better question for us is, how do we guard ourselves against having that kind of hard heart? How do you make sure that your heart is the kind of soft heart that receives faith the way Mary does versus the kind of heart that Judas has? First, I think it's interesting to note that at the root of the chief priest's hatred of Jesus, Scripture tells us that at the root of that hatred was envy. Okay, Mark 15:10. "For he knew," I think referring to Pontius Pilate, "that the chief priests had handed him," Jesus, "over because of envy." Pilate knew that the chief priests were trying to get Jesus killed because of envy. That same verse is repeated in Matthew as well. At the root of this hatred of Christ was envy. This like seeing what he is getting, seeing what he is receiving, seeing who he is, and wanting it for yourself. And because he has it, you start to hate him and you start to plot against him. And it starts to occupy your mind day and night until you figure out, how can I get rid of him? At the root of it was envy. And you can feel it in this part of John. Look at the last verse. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, "You see that you are accomplishing nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." You guys, how little you're doing, because look at the fame. Look at the crowds that gather when he speaks. Look at the devotion that he inspires in people. We're doing nothing. This is not working. Okay, we're gonna have to just kill him because it's not working. And you can see that envy that Jesus' ministry provokes in them. In Proverbs, Solomon says this: "A sound heart is life to the body, but envy is rottenness to the bones." A sound heart, a heart that is complete, a heart that has what it needs, is life. But when you have envy, when you're looking to the side and seeing somebody have something that you want to have, that is, he says, rottenness to the bones. When you look to the left, to the right, they see what others have, and you get an aching hunger in your heart. And Solomon says that your bones start to rot, right? It starts to take you apart. It's leukemia. It's spiritual leukemia because your bones start to rot. The chief priests then, they saw what you might think of as the mojo of Jesus, this inexplicable power that he has over the crowd, this draw that he has. They see this mojo of Jesus and they can't stand it. They can't stand it. Look at John 3. Go back to the life of John the Baptist. John 3, John the Baptist's disciples come to him at verse 26. They came to John and said to him, "Rabbi, he who was with you beyond the Jordan, to whom you have testified, behold, he is baptizing, and all are coming to him." They're complaining, right? He started baptizing, right? You were baptizing first. Like, you've got the trademark, the copyright on baptism. It's in his name, right? John the Baptist. This was his thing. That was his gig. He's baptizing. Jesus shows up, and all the baptisms shift over to him. And his disciples say, "This is not fair. You got to do something about this. This is a problem." And then John, listen to his response. Verse 30. "He must increase, but I must decrease. He must increase, but I must decrease." John sees the mojo go from him to Jesus and says, that is exactly what it should be. That's how it's supposed to be. John the Baptist and Mary are of the same spirit here. Her inheritance is his. She's able to see what Jesus has, and she wants everything to go to him, just as John the Baptist wants everything to go to Christ. Mary delighted to humble herself before Jesus. They see the increase of Jesus and they understand that that's something to delight in. And so when you see that for a moment, then all of a sudden you get this first answer to that question. How do we have hearts that don't do what the Jews did here? And the answer is, it's this humility. It's this understanding that I must decrease, that he might increase. And when you have that, and you start to have wealth or power or fame or some sort of mojo to your left or to your right, it's unthreatening. It doesn't disturb you because your completion is not in what you have, but it's what you have in Christ, right? And you are complete. So ask yourself, where in your life do you see yourself sick with desire? I think it's in Ecclesiastes where Solomon is talking about when you sit at the table of a wealthy man, he says you need to hold a knife to your own throat, right? When you sit next to somebody who has great wealth, it's kind of interesting because as in my job at NSA, as I'm the chief fundraiser for the school, and so you'll find yourself regularly sitting at the table across the table with someone who's worth over $1 billion, and you're sitting there and just thinking, like, you could give me $1 million as easy as you could sneeze, right? You have just wealth just oozing out of you, and it's so easy when you're sitting next to that to, like, have your heart go out of you because you're longing for all of these other things. But Solomon says, no, hold a knife to your throat. When you are sitting next to great, power, great wealth, great mojo in one place or another, you're in a very dangerous spot when you sit there, because you'll start to covet what is there. You'll start to covet what is to the left or to the right. But you need to understand you're complete in Christ. You have everything you need in Christ. Your gaze, your eyes, your heart does not need to wander when you are fixed on Christ. Where in your life then do you see yourself sick with desire? Where do you see someone getting what you believe rightly ought to belong to you? Money is an easy one to do this with. Success is an easy one to do this with. But how about relationships? This is one that I find is making people feel convicted on this is like, you know, hitting the ground with your hat, because it's crazy how much people can deep down on the inside resent other people's friendships. We always have, you know, our entertainment diet is filled with stories of perfect friendships. Perfect friendships, perfect marriages, people who are utterly committed to each other that would never, ever fail or betray one another. And we find frequently in our lives that life is not like that. And so you feel on the inside that people are wronging you because they have not given you this kind of relationship. Perhaps it's a romantic interest that you feel like is owed to you, but it's not coming. It's not happening. Or friendship that is owed to you. Or friendship for your children that ought to be owed to them. You can become, as a parent, more jealous over friendships on behalf of your kids than you are for yourself, because you feel like, okay, they're being excluded. They're not being given the friendships that they ought to give. Or you can do that, I think, oftentimes with like church congregations. You feel like, okay, that church I wasn't immediately invited over for lunch. I wasn't whatever. And you feel like, okay, these churches are not ministering to me the way they're supposed to minister. It's interesting. I was just noticing in Ephesians 4, when Paul is talking about the gifts of the body. And he says, from whom the whole body, he describes all the gifts, from whom the whole body joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. How does the church body grow? By each part knowing what it ought to give. And it's funny because we tend to think by knowing what each part ought to be giving to me and I should be receiving. But Paul says, no, when you show up to the church, you figure out what should I be giving? But our instinct is always to think, what should I be receiving? How are they ministering to me? Not how am I ministering to this body? We can easily twist the way our orientation is supposed to be in Christ, where we are complete in him and our job is to overflow with giving. And we make it instead into this world where everybody is owing us things. Everybody is owing us things. And we become Judas with the money box saying, everybody should be giving so that I can dip into this. But once you allow that kind of envy to take root in your heart, Solomon says you have rottenness in your bones. It's a case of spiritual leukemia, right? And if you find yourself where you have this kind of ache inside, where you're just constantly feeling sort of sour on the inside, and you might be able to put on the sweetest face outside, right? People don't know that you feel like that on the inside. But on the inside, you feel this hollowness, this ache, this constant sort of anger and frustration at people who are not giving you what they ought to give you, I would suggest that you need to humble yourself. You need to learn from John. You need to learn from Mary that you need to humble yourself and quit saying that you were owed these things. Quit saying that these things belong to you by right. Humble yourself. And the great glory is that we're promised, James 4:10, that when you humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, he will lift you up. There's something glorious about John and Mary emptying themselves and knowing that they are raised in Christ and that they are complete in him. And because they know that and they can see that with the eye of faith, they can act so faithfully in these very, very difficult moments. So humility defangs envy. Humility defangs envy. If you have that ache, Embrace humility and you will find it lose all of its power, lose all of its grip on your heart. Follow the example of Mary. Pour yourself out in humility before him. Let the glorious scent of your humility, let that oil of your humility, let that scent fill the room and worship the King in that room. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, would you make our faith like the faith of Mary, that we might see our Savior with the eye of faith and know to empty ourselves before him. May our faith be like the faith of your servant, John the Baptist, that we would delight when we are humbled and your Son is lifted up, that we would know that when we are humbled, we will be lifted up in your Son. Father, teach us to understand the world that we walk in, that we might do so obediently, that we might taste the true joy of life in your Son. And so we pray now as your Son taught us to pray, saying,
one of the ways modern Christianity has been infiltrated by worldliness is through the emphasis on feelings and emotions. How do you know you're a Christian? How do you know your sins are forgiven? How do you know God is with you, that you're walking in the light with him? Frequently, modern Christians have been trained to immediately point to how they feel. That seems to indicate God's presence. The problem is that feelings and emotions are slippery things. Sometimes you feel down because you're tired or hungry. Sometimes you feel good because the sun is out and it's a beautiful day. If you're walking with God, then the fact that the sun is out can certainly be received as bonus, token of God's goodness. But it isn't the foundation of your confidence that God is with you. Remember, God causes the sun to shine on the good and the evil. A serial liar can wake up to the morning sun and feel good, but she really should be feeling bad. On the flip side, you might feel bad because you're tired or hungry. And that's because you've been faithfully pouring yourself out at work or for your family in the strength of Christ. Your feelings are not worthless, but your feelings are not the foundation of your faith. The foundation of your faith is the finished work of Christ, which is true no matter how you feel. And this is why Christ gave us this meal. This meal is an objective sign and seal of your security in Christ. So, are you a guilty sinner? Then you qualify. The blood of Jesus was shed for you. Have you been anxious or worried? Then you qualify. Jesus went to the cross to secure your peace. Here it is for you. Come, eat, and drink, and rejoice. Are you unsure if Christ is with you? He is here. Do you want to walk with him? Then come. Look to Christ, not your feelings, and come and welcome to Jesus Christ. In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he gave thanks. So let's pray together. Our God and Father, we praise you and thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he is our peace. We thank you that he is our peace with you and with those all around us. Father, we praise you and we thank you that he is here with us now. In Jesus' name, amen. You heard this morning in this story of the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem how so many stories are layered on top of one another. God is piling up stories, all this fulfillment, and these two different responses. And nobody really knows what's going on. Nobody really understands because God's moving too fast for everyone to keep up with the stories. But that's really at the heart of the difference between humility and hard-heartedness. The humility submits to it and says, Jesus, you're king, you're telling a story here that I can't keep up with, but I want in. I want to be along for the ride. I don't know what you're doing here, but you're king and I'm all in, like Mary. Or else you're like Judas and you resent it. I can't keep up. I don't know what God's doing here. And you begin to resent it. You begin to envy that your part's not the way you thought it was. That was interesting. You noted John the Baptist, and that's his name. Well, of course, it wasn't his name at that moment. But notice, what does he do? He gives up the one thing he was known for. And what does he get? Eternity as John the Baptist. Right? When you give up the things maybe that are dearest to you, and you lay it all at the feet of Jesus, and you say, I'm all in, my inheritance, all that I am, the things that I thought I was known for, and you lay it all at the feet of Jesus and you say, your story's the best story. I want in on your story. What happens? He gives it back. Now, he may not give it back to you exactly in the way that you thought he was going to give it back, but he piles it up 30, 60, and 100-fold, and it's way better because he knows what he's doing. Now, receive with believing hearts the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. And amen.